His presence. I couldn't run, couldn't run from His arms. Jesus, He loves me. He loves me. He is for me. Jesus, how can
a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. Where all the comes flow.
come, thou fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious song, and sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon, it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come, and I good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus saw me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Prone to wonder, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
It's great to be in the house of the Lord this morning. If you're excited about being here, say amen. Amen. That's good. Now, if you're really excited about being here, say amen. Ready? Amen. Thank you. Thank you. We're going to start our service today. I'm going to do the prelude, and I'm going to do what I consider a fun arrangement of Over in the Glory Land.
Oh, Morning, church family. Allow me to call us into worship this morning with just a thought that goes along with our theme today. And it is this: there is only one true God. And it's only because of Him that we truly exist this morning. The only reason why we have breath, the only reason why you were able to gather here this morning, the only reason why you're able to sit down at your table this morning and have some breakfast and a hot coffee, even with a bad supply chain, was all because of the only true God that we serve. That's the only reason why. And this morning, He calls and summons us to worship Him. And so I want to read one verse as we consider the truth of the only true God. And this is from Psalm chapter 50, verse 1. The mighty one, God the Lord, speaks, and He summons the earth from the rising of the sun and to its setting. This morning, the only reason why we can gather and sing is because of the only true God that we serve. So remember, as we sing, He keeps me singing as I go. As we sing that chorus this morning, reminding yourselves in your hearts, it's not because I have great lungs, it's not because I have a great voice, it's not because of any of these things. For all the skills in which we possess, it's only because of our one true God. Therefore, let us stand together and worship our Lord this morning and sing together as His people, He keeps me singing. Church, let us pray this morning. Lord, we confess this morning that no one compares to You. No one. Lord, You are the source of life. Lord, You're the reason why we can come and approach and worship You this morning because of Your abounding grace. And so, Lord, I pray that this song that we carry this morning as your people singing your praises, Lord, I pray that as we leave this building this morning, even after we are done here in worship in a corporate setting, Lord, I pray that every single day upon our lips, we would praise you and sing everywhere we go. For, Lord, you have been so, so good to us. Lord, that's my prayer for all of us. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, good morning, church family. Obviously, I am not Pastor Jim. Pastor has a GI bug, and so just please be praying for Pastor. He does not have COVID. He's being taken care of by Myra, which, of course, you know, this awesome, awesome family. And just so let's pray for Pastor, for him regaining his strength. And this has been a rough, like really 24 to 48 hours has been pretty rough for him. So just pray for Pastor. And of course, you are stuck with my smiling face this morning as I lead us in worship. Just a few notes as we think about church here, because this is our last Sunday in this building before we transition over to Adventure Church. So next Sunday, February 20th, we will not be gathering in here. If you come in here, you probably won't see pews. And no one will be in here, which should be the indication you're in the wrong place next week. We'll be gathering in the fellowship hall next week for worship at 10:45 for Adventure Church, so don't miss it. Also, do note, we want to encourage you, if you are watching the Monday update this week, Pastor was actually encouraging all of us to take some pictures after service this morning. Because when you walk in here, late March, early April, the colors will be different. The sanctuary will look different. We've seen these same colors for 30 years in the life of our church. And I would love for us to create some memories with friends and family. And so this morning, after worship, I actually encourage you as a pastor to pull out your phones and to get together with friends and family and to take some pictures this afternoon after worship. Two other notes. Number one, men, we are gathering this Thursday, 6:30 p.m. for Man Church, so don't miss it, men. And also, Young Hearts is the following Thursday on the 24th. We're having Troutman's Barbecue for lunch, so don't miss it. And we'll be meeting at noon. So don't miss those two opportunities for fellowship and worship and Bible study. And to our guests, thank you for joining us here in worship this morning. We pray that you experience the love of Christ, not just simply through our songs, but that you truly experience the love of Christ through how we greet and love and care for one another. And therefore, I want to encourage everyone to participate in this time of greeting. I pray, ask everyone to stand up, please, and take a few moments to greet those around you in the name of the Lord.
Gotta love the technical problems that just get caught, that just get fixed by jiggling a wire. Gotta love.
With all the joy that I hear this morning, let us sing together, "Open Up the Heavens."
We're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our place. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now, Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river. Feeling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our
work is finished, the end is written.
lost his grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah.
Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost his grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, his grip on me. Yes, I've broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. God, you are my living hope.
Please be seated.
All right, kids, you can come on down front. Good morning. All right, so while we're waiting, if you were not in Sunday school, you can go to the library after church and get your, I guess they're right here, and get your Valentine bag, okay? So you have your Valentine's bags are outside of the library ready to be picked up. All right, who can tell me why we have rules? Nick? To be safe? Mm-hmm. Do y'all like rules?
Yeah. Sometimes.
Sometimes?
Yeah.
Sometimes? Yeah. What's one rule that you don't like? Nick?
Cleaning up the den.
Cleaning up the den? Miles? Cleaning up after yourself, Morgan?
Chase the dog all over,
Genevieve? No electronics during the week, Malia?
Having to let the dog in.
Having to let the dog in, yeah. Well, another rule, one of the Ten Commandments, is having no other gods. How many gods are there?
One,
that's right. So in the Bible, we read all these things. We read, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. We read, you shall have no other gods before me. We also read, you shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents. So does God want us to worship other gods? No. What are some other gods that people worship? Nick? Zeus? Okay. All right. So there's like other gods like Zeus. Okay, Malia?
Fake ones.
Fake ones. Okay. Did you say Poseidon? Okay. So there's like gods like that. And there's also gods like people might worship like the TV. Like that's they love their TV more than God. Not like they worship it like they sing songs to it, but like they want to watch TV more than they want to learn about God, those kind of things. So we should only be worshiping God. We only have one God. How do you think your parents would feel if you started calling a tree mom or dad? Can a tree be your mommy or daddy? No. All right, so it would be silly to call them that. And do you think it would make your parents sad if you were like, Okay, you're not my mom. That tree is my mom. You think that would make them sad? Yeah. So it's kind of the same with us and God. When we call other things our God, so like if we spend too much time on our electronics and not enough time with God, that makes God sad. And there is only one God, and the other gods are not real. The other gods are like demons tricking people into believing them. So how many of you have ever played dress up, or you dress up for Halloween? I know you haven't played dress up, Nick, but I know you dress up for Halloween. How many of you have ever worn a mask? Not a mask like to protect you from germs, but like a mask like to be Spider-Man or something.
Well, actually, I have for one of my costumes.
Yeah. Okay, so if you wear a mask, are you still Malia? Yeah. Okay, if I put on a mask and I was pretending to be Spider-Man, am I still Miss Corrigan? Okay, so I'm still me underneath. So the demons can look like other things and make up stories to make people believe in other gods, but they're still the demons underneath. They don't want us to believe in God, so they'll trick people any way they can. If we worship just one God, we are worshiping and serving the real God. God is the one who made the world and the plants and the animals and you and me. He is the one who loves us and takes care of us, and that's why he wants us to worship only him, because he is the only God that's real. We shouldn't make idols. An idol is something that we worship other than God. It could be a statue of another God, or it could even be a statue of the real God. We can't worship anything that isn't the real God. God isn't a statue or a painting or anything else. But there's one more thing about false gods and idols that we should remember. God said not to put any other gods before him. But there are times when we do put things before God. If God tells us not to do something and we do it anyway, you're putting what you want to do before God. You're saying that what you want to do is more important than God. Is that right or wrong? Wrong. If it's time to spend time with God by reading your Bible or praying or going to church and you decide to do something else instead, you're putting that before God. You're saying that something else in your life is more important, and that's wrong. God is the most important part of our lives, and we should honor him by not putting any false gods or anything else we want to do before him.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're grateful to come into your holy presence and worship this morning. We praise you and thank you for our salvation in Jesus. We lift up our sick and hurting and pray for your healing touch, Heavenly Father. Let our priority always be your kingdom work. Accept our tithes and offerings this morning as a gift of worship to you. Bless the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church family. Today, I wanted to share a song that I wrote and put together with the help of Alec Lakovich and my uncle Greg Cagle. I encourage everyone to listen to the lyrics, and I hope it serves as a reminder that God is with us through our darkest times. Give your fear and anxiety to him, and he will always be there, because we serve such a mighty and loving God. And trials. You see, I
So last night around 5:30 to 6 p.m. is when my mind began to think about this sermon. And Pastor, in his grace and mercy toward me as a young pastor, sent me his outline in prep for this morning. And I noticed looking over the outline there were three main points and three subpoints to each point. And typically for my style of preaching, I usually give about 10 minutes to each point. So I begin to calculate 10 times 12 equals 120 minutes, and therefore 2 hours. So if for some reason you begin, if I see you start beginning to leave, I will also show you grace and mercy of our Lord. Pastor is entitled this sermon, Alone in the Marketplace. And someone who's experienced loneliness and at times wrestled with depression, one of the things that always has encouraged my heart and God has used to encourage my own soul as something I've turned to in moments has been music and actually movies. From my father, I inherited a love for music. You can ask my mom. Wherever we may travel, wherever we may go, we were always playing music, and that was really a blessing in my life, that was something I turned to when I was lonely. But over the years, I developed to really love movies. And all of us can probably name our top 5, top 10 movies, and all of us would have different categories and differences on our list. But probably my top 5 would be a movie called Shawshank Redemption. Raise your hand if you've ever seen that movie before. Most in this room have. It's a powerful movie. And there is a character in that movie named Brooks. Brooks is an elderly man who is a librarian. He has been in Shawshank, this prison, for 50 years. In the prison, he has purpose and meaning and fellowship with the other prisoners because they understand what it's like to live within the prison. But when he reaches 50 years in this prison, he is released, and they send him off to a halfway house. And while he's in this halfway house, he is able to find a job. He begins working in the local grocery store, a marketplace, bagging groceries. And what is so interesting about the character of Brooks is that even though he is surrounded by people on all sides and literally serving and helping others, he struggles with loneliness and depression. He wrestles and deals with things that he does not share with others there in his loneliness. The sad part of Brooke's story, if you know the movie, is that in his loneliness, he turns to take his own life. And as he stands there, he's isolated himself. He's in his room all by himself. Before he takes his life, he pulls out a pocket knife and he writes on the walls three words: Brooks was here. There are two ways in which you can respond to being alone, the experience of loneliness. Now, these are not the only two responses, but these are the two most common. Either number one, you can turn to isolation and depression. But number two, you can also turn to hope and engagement. Allow me to confess this morning. We may not speak it out loud, but in our hearts and our minds, these thoughts do resound in the back of them. We as Christians are beginning to feel lonely. Even tonight, as you turn on the Super Bowl, if you decide to partake in the activities this evening, you will watch all the commercials. You'll watch all the events that take place, and you'll think to yourself, there is nothing of Christian resemblance within anything of our culture. None of our values are represented. None of our beliefs are represented. We feel like the minority. It feels like slowly and slowly culture no longer values what we value. The majority, to be quite honest, do not worship God. Many have turned away from the truth of Scripture, and actually many of them don't know. What you may not realize is that something I experience in doing ministry within schools and even a part of FCA is that this week, as I was talking with our FCA director here in Concord, is the reality that many of our children who are growing up in our schools have never been to a church, have no knowledge of scriptures, have no background with the people of God. They are completely ignorant of all of these things, and that is the culture in which we find ourselves in. And to be quite frank, our culture has turned to other idols. Now, most of them have not turned to Zeus, which is an idol. But also, I think they really, Corgan laid them out real clear. They've turned to pleasure, self-autonomy, relationships, success, wealth, health, intellect, comfort. Our culture has made these things their gods. And as Christians, we have two roads in front of us that we can take, two opportunities that we can hold on to. The one, I would highly discourage, but I see that temptation. The real temptation to take the road of isolation and disengagement. Well, the world's changing. They no longer want to hear us. They do not worship the true God. Therefore, let's just step back and isolate ourselves from the world and just hope for the best. I see that real temptation. Or the opposite approach we can take is that we, with hope and a stirring in our hearts, can engage the culture with the truth of the good news of Scripture. Even if many reject us, even if the world thinks we are absolutely absurd, my encouragement to you is this morning. Just like Paul is going to end the scripture that we're about to read in Acts 17, we must engage. Because as you turn to Acts 17, and I would encourage you to do so now, I want to sort of set up this sermon a little bit different than maybe previously. I want to provide the context and the setting for which we're about to read in, because the culture in which Paul is encountering, the culture which Paul is about to engage in with the good news of the gospel, is very akin to our own culture. And so as you're sitting there in your seats with your Bibles open, let us actually read together verses 16 through 21. And this is really going to provide context for today's message. Now while Paul was waiting for them at Athens, his spirit was provoked within him as he saw that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and the devout persons and in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. Some of the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers also conversed with him. And some said, "What does this babbler wish to say?" And others said, "He seems to be a preacher of foreign divinities, because he was preaching Jesus and the resurrection." And they took him and brought him to the Areopagus, saying, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? For you bring some strange things to our ears, and we wish to know, therefore, what these things mean." Now all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there would spend their time in nothing except telling or hearing something new. Now, by this time, Athens is not the center of political power. At one time, just three or four centuries earlier, the center of power was in Athens. But by this time, of course, this is the Roman Empire. But all of the Roman Empire was influenced by the Greek culture. And the center of that culture could be found in Athens. Now, we see pictures of Athens today, and it is a beautiful city. We see all of the art and the literature. I mean, this was the center of the thought life of truly the whole Roman Empire. It was a city full of temples and images and idols made to gods and goddesses. Actually, Nick, there was actually a temple and a goddess made up to who? Zeus. That was the period and the time. And what's interesting is that Paul's not like us. Meaning, like, when I see on my phone an advertisement that we have a chance to go to Greece, oh man, get my phone, get my camera, pack my bags. I want to take a picture of all the artwork, all of the temples, all the idols. This is so cool. All the archaeology. Man, I can't wait to go to Greece. That wasn't Paul's attitude. What's interesting about the text is that as he observed all these things, the Bible said he was literally stirred in his heart. There literally was this anger. Why? Why was he stirred? He looked around and he realized something. They don't know the truth. They don't know the true God. They're ignorant. They have no understanding, and they need to hear. Like, he understands that he looks at this full city, thousands of people worshiping all these gods and goddesses, and he realizes that none of them know the truth. And if no one shares, obviously no one will believe. So he could at this point in time walk away discouraged and think, "I am the only Christian in this city. There is no way I am going to open my mouth and get myself in trouble again." He could literally say, "You know what? This city is too cultured. It's too pagan. I just need to step away from this." But he doesn't. He decides to engage them. And actually, it was his custom. He went first to where? The synagogue. He went first to the place where they knew the Old Testament scriptures, began to explain how Christ fulfilled the scriptures. But also, he engaged those who had no knowledge of God whatsoever. I could just see Paul as he's walking through and he sees a woman about to walk into a temple and literally give her body over to worship a god or goddess. And he's like, ma'am, why are you going in there? Ma'am, you don't understand. Just because you go into that temple does not mean that you're going to have children. Let me tell you about the one who is the source of all life." Or maybe he walked to another man. Sir, Don't go in there because you think you're going to receive good crops. Instead, listen to me. I know the source of all things. I know the one who created all things, including the rain, the food, and crops. I could see Paul just engage with these people who did not know the truth. And there were actually two groups of people in which he engaged in that actually were really polar opposites. You see there in verse 18, the Epicureans and the Stoics. Two rival factions were in this city. One, as you heard from Corgan already, sort of alluded to already, was the Stoics. They believed God was in everything. God is in the trees, the animals, the food. But they were very, very ethical people. They held very high moral standards. And then you have the Epicureans. They believe God had no interest in man whatsoever at all. God does not care about mankind, period. And that ultimately the goal in life was about pleasure. It was about truly comfort and a life free from pain. That was the purpose of the Epicureans. And these groups, they didn't care that Paul was actually speaking to them. It upset them. They believed that no reasonable person could believe the message that Paul was bringing. Now, think about this. They call Paul a babbler, okay? It's the idea that he just picks up bits and pieces of information and throws it together. And really, they considered him a sort of worthless, sort of a nobody. Paul, you're absurd. Jesus and the resurrection, no one wants to hear that. And if you look through all the Greco-Roman writings of that same time period, they would call Christians irrational, fanatical. Their beliefs threatened the stability of society. They were excessive. Some went as far as to say they are depraved and deadly. Does that sound familiar at all? Does it sound familiar that our culture says that what we're saying as Bible-believing Christians to be absurd, fanatical, irrational? Truly, this would be the way in which our culture characterizes Christians. However, the beautiful part of God opening doors is that still they gave Paul an audience here. You see, they gathered in this place where truly it was the seat of all reason. Every day they would discuss religion and morals. Now, Paul wasn't on trial, but if Paul wanted an audience, this is the place to have an audience to share the good news of Jesus. And these people, man, they'll take anything. They're literally caught up in every single new teaching and belief the world is producing. And in this context is where we get this speech today. So with your Bibles open, let us stand up and let us read God's word together. Paul's sermon in Acts 17 and verses 22 through 31 this morning. So here's Paul's sermon. So Paul is standing in the midst of the Areopagus, said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. For as I passed along, I observed the objects of your worship. I found also an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God.' What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you, the God who made the world and everything in it, being the Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mankind life and breath and everything. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place, that they should seek God and perhaps feel their way toward him and find him. Yet he is actually not far from each of one of us, For in him we live and move and have our being, as even as some of your own poets have said, for we are indeed his offspring. Being then God's offspring, we ought not to think the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and the imagination of man. The times of ignorance God overlooked. But now, he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this, he has given assurance to all by the raising him from the dead. Let us pray. Lord, I thank you that as we begin to think about how to encounter and to engage our culture, that through your word this morning, you can encourage your people that we truly have the only message that brings life everlasting. For Lord, you are the only true God. There is no one like you. Everything bows down towards you. There is none greater than you. And so, Lord, I pray as we think about engaging our coworkers and our friends and our neighbors and our culture around us with the good news, Lord, I pray that we would not shrink away, that we would not isolate ourselves and turn within, but Lord, I pray with hope and a stirring in our hearts, I pray we would engage this culture with the truth of your word. Lord, give us the strength and the boldness to do so. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. Again, as I said, this outline in grace was provided to me from Pastor, and I am doing my very best this morning not to lengthen this another 2 hours. And therefore, let's begin where Paul begins. Number one, there is only one God. There is only one God. When you present the gospel to people who have no understanding of the scriptures, they have no background in the Old Testament, they didn't grow up in church, they didn't attend a synagogue, when you encounter people like that, you begin right here. There's only one living and true God. Now we know that all of creation points to the reality, that truth, that there is only one true and living God. And yet, we know according to Romans 1, we as human beings who truly turn away from the Lord, we worship ourselves, we worship idols instead of the one who literally created us all. And so knowing truly his audience, an audience that loved wisdom, an audience that loved understanding and new things and new ideas, Paul knew this is where to begin. There is only one and true Lord. Now, the Old Testament, remember, is unfamiliar to them. But don't be confused. What we're reading right here in this sermon is rooted in the Bible. All that Paul is saying here is not coming from the Greeks or from other thoughts. Everything you hear from Paul's mouth is actually from God's word itself. God is creator of all, God is judge of all, and there is only one God. You will not find that in any other Greek philosophy or thought life or anywhere else. So the message in which you hear, he's just not pulling out of the thin air. Everything is rooted in the reality of Scripture. He knew how to engage his audience. So yes, he will quote in this time two Greek poets. He will refer to them. But everything he says to this audience who doesn't know anything about the Bible, he is conveying to them the truth that is only found in Scripture. And what I love about Paul is how he engages them. I can just see Paul walk through, and you see all these temples of gods and goddesses, and he looks, and there is this form, there's this idol, And on the inscription, it says, to an unknown God. Which means that obviously the Greeks really believed they were trying to respect this God. They were honoring this God. They were worshiping this God. They don't know who he is. But if he's out there somewhere, we got a place for you. We have an idol made for you. We'll make sure to acknowledge you. And Paul seizes on this moment. Paul seizes on this to an unknown God, and he knows now how he's going to communicate with them. This God that you're ignorant of, this God that you don't know about, this God that you speculate about, I'm going to tell you about this God. But it's not what you think it is. This God is the only true God, period. And he would seize on that opportunity. And this true God, I want to proclaim three things this morning that Paul proclaims in this sermon. Number one, this true God, he is the source of all things. The God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth. The true God created everything. It wasn't a few gods. There wasn't a battle in the sky between who made the earth or who gives the rain and who gives the crops. But there's only one God who is Lord of everything. They're not little lords and little gods who control different bits and pieces of the earth. There's one Lord over everything. And all that exists is only because of this true God. The only reason why, think about this, church, the only reason why we are here this morning and breathing and have oxygen and have food and functioning this morning is because of the only true God who created everything. It's only because of him. And the beautiful part about the truth of creation, we are made in the image of our Lord. We are made in the image of God. We're not like the rest of creation. I mean, our intellect, our faculties, everything that we have should point to the reality that there is one supreme, only preeminent God that's the source of all things. And that's where Paul begins this argument. Second, he says, he sustains all things since he himself, verse 25, gives himself to all mankind life and breath and everything. Let me encourage you, church, this morning. God lacks absolutely nothing, period. There's nothing he lacks. There is nothing that he turns to humankind and says, you know what? I don't have that in my collection. I need that in my collection. No, everything that we have, any skills, abilities, money, clothes, anything we have is only because God has actually created and given unto us. He lacks nothing. I love this about Psalm 50. That's why I begin this morning there. He owns the cattle on what? 1,000 hills. The birds and all the beasts for the world in its fullness are mine. He supplies everything. Literally, life, breath, everything. Maybe it's just me. But sometimes in my sin, I miss that. Like, I think that the reason why I have breath this morning is because I forced myself to go to sleep last night at a good time. Or the reason why I have strength this morning is because I made a good cup of coffee this morning. Like, I think we really convince ourselves that it's because of us that we even exist and move and breathe. But the reality of the scripture is that everything that exists, exists because of God, period. And I find that just so glorious. The rain, the food, the crops. The supply chain is actually dependent upon God. Because there is no supply chain, there is no food, there is no crops, there's no farms, none of that exists except for God. All of these things he sustains. And I think it's just something that is beautiful in how Paul preaches this sermon. And third, he is sovereign over all things. He rules, he reigns over all things. Verse 26, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling places. Church, God will carry out his plan. God's going to execute his plan. He will carry out what he desires. Not only is he creator and sustainer, but literally he sets the boundaries for people groups and countries and inheritance. The reason why we are living in America right now is because of God. The reason why there are nations right now and boundaries for those nations, it's because of God. We think, oh, well, sovereign nations establish their boundaries. Let me encourage you, church, there's only one sovereign. We try to convince ourselves that we are absolutely sovereign, that we have self-autonomy, that we rule ourselves. We're kidding ourselves if we really think we rule ourselves. There's only one person who is sovereign over all things and rules and reigns from on high, and that is our God. No one else is sovereign. Even Moses acknowledges this. Before they go into the promised land, at the very end of Deuteronomy, he gave to the nations their inheritance, and he fixed the bounds of the people. Sustainer, creator, all of these things, sovereign. They should have obviously turned to the Lord. They should have obviously, wow, let's worship him. But sadly, instead, they worship idols. Worship idols created in their own image. Worship gods that they could actually serve and respect and think they could control. However, this one true God cannot be served. If you're taking notes, this point number two, this one God cannot be served. Notice in Acts 17, 24 and then 29, our God does not live in temples made by man. Being then, verse 29, God's offspring, we ought not to think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and the imagination of man. Church, God doesn't need anything. This is something that we should find rest and comfort in, but also should remind us daily in how we worship and serve him. There is nothing that we possess that God needs. He doesn't need anything. He doesn't need forms of silver and gold. He doesn't need our money. Like, listen, we are all called to obedience, to give and tithes and offering. But everything you just gave, God already possesses it. The homes you're living in, God already possesses it. Everything that you have, your clothes, your shoes, your automobiles, everything you have, God literally owns everything. And he doesn't even need our skills. Like, I'm thankful that God has given me the opportunity and the ability to preach. And you have to bear the weight of listening to me for 45 minutes. That's a skill. It takes time to bear that weight. I understand. But God does not have need of that. The voice that I have right now speaking unto you was given by God. All this he truly owns. He does not need anything. Point number two, we can't earn favor by giving him anything. What those in Athens didn't realize, and what our culture doesn't realize, is that you think you can curry the favor of the gods and goddesses. If I give my body, if I give my money, if I give my time, if I give my energy, if I give my respect, then I can manipulate God to give me favor. I can manipulate God to give me good crops. I can manipulate God to give me wealth or children. God's not like that. We can't earn favor by giving him anything. And then number three, we can't contain him in our systems. The true God doesn't inhabit sanctuaries. Now I'm going to blow your mind. God's bigger than this sanctuary. Now listen, I love this place that we have the opportunity to gather and worship together. But God is not contained within this sanctuary. And you might think to yourself, well, wait a minute. What about the temple? Wasn't God's presence in the temple? Didn't the temple contain his presence? Well, Solomon acknowledged it didn't. Remember what Solomon prayed for before the people of God? But God, will you indeed dwell in the earth? Behold, heaven and the highest heaven cannot contain you. How much less this house that I have built for you. There is nothing that can contain our God. And this God who doesn't need anything, this God whom we can't curry favor and earn favor by giving of ourselves, he calls us to do one thing. He calls us to repent. Number three, this one true God calls us to repent. You see, truly our relationship with the one true God begins with us recognizing that he is preeminent. We must realize God's preeminence. Verse 27, that they should seek God and perhaps feel their way toward him and find him. Yet he is actually not far from each one of us. Verse 30, the times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent because he has fixed the day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. Being made in the image of God, seeing the animals and the trees and the birds, that should have turned us as humans and worshiped and acknowledged him. We should have feared him. We should have loved him. We don't have an excuse. That's the whole argument of Romans 1 and 2. Whether you are a Gentile who has no knowledge of the scriptures, or whether you are a Jew and you understand the law in the Old Testament, no one has an excuse before God. You should have turned and feared the Lord. We should have sought him. We should have found him. But we didn't. We didn't. We should have recognized that he was preeminent, not ourselves. But we didn't. But you know, our God's merciful. Our God is long-suffering. Our God has shown us more grace and more mercy than we can ever, ever count. And that while we were yet sinners, while we were still ignorant, while we were still worshiping idols, yet Christ died for us. He came and lived a perfect life. The only true God who deserved all of worship literally humbled himself, came to this earth, lived perfection, lived a perfect life, didn't deserve the death that he received, but he died in the place for you and for me. And he is now alive and at the right hand of the Father. And the glorious part of the gospel, the good news, is that the only true God is not like what the Stoics and the Epicureans believed. They would say, well, God doesn't care about human beings. They would say that, well, God's in the trees and the birds and the animals. And God says, no. Even though they have fallen, even though they have sinned, even though they have rebelled, in my love and in my long suffering, I now send my son. Therefore, turn to him and repent. We must recognize that he is preeminent. We must recognize God's power. We must recognize in this passage the truth that truly he is the judge of all. Every single one of us are accountable unto God. He alone has the power to save, and he alone has the power to raise the dead to life. I've always find it both comforting as a Christian, but troubling for those who don't believe the reality that Christ will be the judge of all. You see, one day when we see our Savior face to face, it will be comforting for us, for those who believe. We will be comforted to know that the one who died for us and gave his life for us is right in front of us. And that will bring us comfort. But those who do not believe, there will be no excuse for them. They will see the hands and the feet, the scars. And they know at that time it will be too late. They still will have to bow the knee. They will still have to proclaim him as Lord of all. But by that time, when he comes to judge, it will be too late. Therefore, the call now is that we are called to recognize his power now. And then last, we must reorganize our perspective. This is the call for us this morning. This is the message that as Christians we proclaim to a world that seems to be growing more and more secular by the moment. Church, I know that we feel like the minority. I know sometimes it feels like no one's listening to us. It feels like culture's just running headlong into hell and that wants nothing to do with us. But you know what the beautiful thing about this whole event is that even though there were a few who completely misunderstood and many of them thought he was absurd and talking about all different types of things, we still know according to the scriptures that two people believed the gospel that day and followed Christ. Church, it is worth to engage the culture even if only two people come to Christ. So let me encourage you, do not fall the temptation to isolate as a church or as individuals or as families from this culture that seems to be growing more and more antagonistic toward our faith. Because I can tell you, if you turn inwardly, you will become depressed. You will begin to feel lonely and think, man, we are the minority. This is not going to change. Things are going to get worse. And I'm just going to sit here at home and sob in my bed until Jesus comes back. That's the one option you have on that end. But on the other hand, we can engage the culture. We can share the good news of Christ. And yes, some people will laugh at us. Some people will find us absurd. They will think that we're ridiculous. But that does not change the reality that God is preeminent, that God is power, that he is creator of all, and that he is still saving. Hear me, church. He is still saving people from all languages and tongues. He is saving people here in Concord, North Carolina, this morning. I truly believe that with all my heart. So as a church, I want to encourage us, let us not shy away. Let us not be depressed. Let us follow in Paul's example and engage our culture with the truth of the good news of Jesus. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to have a time of prayer for us to respond to God's word. And there's three things I think I want to bring forth to us this morning in prayer. First of all, the same call that Paul gives in this sermon is the call that he gives to us all. It is the call to repentance. Now, repentance does not mean simply adding Jesus to your life. I think sometimes if we're not careful, we can portray to others when we proclaim the good book that truly is just, here's your life, and then I add Jesus to the end in order that I can get to heaven. That's not the message of Scripture. The message of God's word is that we are called to truly turn away, completely reorient our lives to whole devotion to our Lord, repent of our sins, and place our faith in Christ alone. And so that's our first call this morning. If you've never done that before, there is no better time to turn to Christ than now. No better time. But also, there are potentially idols in our own life that we as people who claim Christ need to turn from. Maybe it's the idol of pleasure. Maybe it's the idol of wealth. Maybe it's the idol of intellect. Maybe there are some things in our life that we've made more important and preeminent than God himself. So this morning is an opportunity for us to pray in that way as well. And then last, I encourage you that if you're not part of a church family, to become part of ours. Now listen, understand, our church, we are by no means a perfect church, and if you're looking for a perfect church, you will never find one. But if you want to be a part of a church that points to the truth of Scripture, that truly strives to make Christ preeminent in all things, that truly strives to glorify God, whether through serving or music or preaching, that's who we are. And so I encourage you this week, if you want to be part of a church like that, contact me, contact Pastor Jim. Truly, this would be a fellowship for you, because that's what we're all about, is making Christ preeminent. So church, I'm going to pray. I'm going to close this out in a prayer. And if any of these three apply in your life, that's what I want you to pray about. I don't know your hearts. I don't know where you stand with the Lord. I don't know what you're struggling with idols in your life. But as I pray this morning, as you're in there in your seats, I want you to pray as well. I'm praying not for you to listen to me. I am praying that also you would pray and seek the Lord this morning. And if this is your first time that you've ever truly made a profession of faith and say, Lord, I'm turning my sins and repenting and putting my faith in you. If this is your first time, don't hesitate after this service to grab me, to grab another man or woman around you and say, this is my first time of truly following after Jesus. Can you explain this a little bit more to me? Don't hesitate. Grab me, grab someone else. So as I pray, church, let us pray about these things. Lord, I am thankful that we can gather around your word this morning. Lord, I am thankful for Paul's example that he did not shy away or shrink away when he felt lonely and felt isolated. But instead, he engaged a culture that was full of idols. Those who are completely ignorant of the truth, yet, Lord, he engaged them with the truth of God's word. Lord, I pray that as we encounter others, Lord, that truly we would proclaim that you are creator and sustainer of all, that no one compares to you. Lord, I pray that the message we would proclaim as your people is that, Lord, you have no need of anything. And that, Lord, you call us to turn away. To turn away from our sin, to turn away from our idols, to turn away from making everything else preeminent over you. Lord, you call us to turn away from that. Turn away from our sin and put our faith in you. So, Lord, I pray, Lord, that is the first time for someone here in this room. Lord, I pray today they would not waste time, they would not put it off, they would not forget about it, but Lord, I pray right now they would turn to you in faith. But Lord, I pray second of all as well that you would, Lord, search our own hearts. Lord, as Christians at times we have made idols. Lord, we have sometimes put things above you that we shouldn't. And so, Lord, if that is true in any of our lives, Lord, I pray this morning that we would repent and turn away from those things. And Lord, I pray that you would continue to bring more and more to this church, Lord, who have never known you before. Lord, I pray that we would see, Lord, truly tens and hundreds come to faith in Christ. Lord, I pray that they would come and be baptized and be a part of our fellowship, Lord. Lord, I pray that we would be a church that makes you preeminent in all these things. Lord, I pray that even as we get ready for Adventure Church and have a huge transition in the life of our church. Remind us, oh Lord, that truly you're even preeminent and above even that. Lord, thank you for this time together that we gather around your word. In Jesus' name, amen. So, church, here's going to do a few things and a little bit different for closing. Before we sing the doxology, I want to encourage you to just take some time after worship to spend with your friends and family and even new faces, maybe your first-time guests. Don't feel like you have to run off. Stay here, greet, love one another, and just spend some time together. I encourage you, yes, and students, I give you permission, bring out your phones. Bring out your smartphones. Take some pictures together and just enjoy together, because the next time we meet in here in 4 to 6, 7 weeks, this will look very different. So after you've seen the doxology, let's enjoy one another and let's be thankful that truly God is preeminent over all things. Okay, if you don't mind, just a few house cleaning items as we prepare for transition. Number one, you will notice that there are hymnals in front of you. I am not encouraging you to take these home. What I'm encouraging you to do is that on your way out, if you don't mind, pick up one or two hymnals and just drop it off in the bridal parlor. Second of all, if there's a few men who can help Howard, we're going to have to transition a few things from music over to the fellowship hall afterwards. So there's a few men who don't mind sticking around just for a little bit. That would be a huge help as we transition over. Yeah, so just, we have a lot of work we got to get to done. But first of all, thank you. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for your work. Thank you for corking to be my memory that I've lost. And church, it's just awesome to worship together. Let us all stand. Howard, would you lead us in the doxology as we worship our Lord this morning?